Our call to worship. Listen up, everyone. God has given us work to do. God has called each one of us before we were even born. It was God who named us. It is God who claims us. The light of God's love shines in us. Let shine God's love into all the world. We sing our first song from Tis 155, How Great Thou Art.
Oh,
welcome to each and every one of us this morning, in person or if you are watching it at home. As is the custom, we live stream this service, so a seat in the rear of the church ensures you will not be captured by the camera. As you know, this is a special morning. We will be commissioning the elders and the church councillors. And after the service, there'll be morning tea followed by a Sozzle Sizich lunch, shared lunch. Malcolm will bring the message today. Roy will read the scripture. Graham is our musician. Russell and Ken are on the data. And my name is Tineke. Now, Malcolm and Sue would like to speak.
Good morning. You may not have noticed, but when you came in this morning on our welcome slide, there was also some other words. Church councillors over last year and the Worship Planning Committee, we've sort of thought that we would like to frequently, to use that time for the slide to be a thinking time or a place to be something to consider. So when you come in, as well as greeting others in your preparation for coming to worship, you might want to just pause and cast your eyes up to the slide. It's not just a welcome, it's also some thoughts for us. And if we look at that slide particularly again, I think there it is, it's a rephrase of the Ten Commandments. So because we were unaware of it, let's just pause for this moment. Practice loyalty to the sacred. Do not forget that any given image of God is only a glimpse. Do not use God's name to do harm. Do not let life be defined by productivity. It's the meaning behind keep the Sabbath holy and restful. Our focus is not to be always doing. Number five, care for those who cared for you. Do not be destructive. Be faithful to the commitments that you make. That one's poignant for today as we reflect upon commissioning and covenanting. Do not take what does not belong to you. Do not hinder justice from coming to fruition. And do not let your internal desires lead you to harm one another. So that's just a sample of what you might find when you come into the church. Have a glance at the welcome slide and pause for a moment to consider what these words or the image might be saying to us. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Sue. Nominally the pastoral care ministry person on our church council. And during the last little while with COVID has been with us, many issues arose and our pastoral care groups changed in the way they met or didn't meet at all, and I think now is the time to perhaps reactivate and just see where we are with our pastoral groups. So today, during our time of tea and coffee and sausage sizzle and ice cream, sausage sizzle, yes, and there is a suggestion that we could sit together in our pastoral groups or not, or with anyone you choose to sit with, of course. But some people actually aren't in designated groups. So if you see a space, just ask someone to join you and maybe start a conversation and see where we can all join together. So the pastoral groups were introduced to Brighton many years ago, and Gwen Haseman was the instigator of that and did such a wonderful job organising it early. And the idea was that we keep in touch with each other in smaller groups, rather than one person being responsible for how we all are together. And that was usually the minister, and the minister's got other things to do. But the wonderful thing is that Malcolm is a wonderful pastoral care person, and he mostly joins in with the pastoral groups when they meet for their various ways, maybe a lunch, maybe tea and coffee, maybe just a gathering. So it is wonderful that Malcolm actually includes in those group gatherings, and it's a wonderful chance for you to get to know him, and he can get to know you as well. So there is overlap between the pastoral groups, and I often think that things like the day fellowship and the singles ministry group, the prayer group, are pastoral care groups within themselves, and then those people actually are in other groups. So there's nothing to stop you being part of two or three or four groups. This is an evolving, inclusive ministry. We're all encouraged to work together, to care for each other in this way. So may we enjoy our lunch together and our talk and chat, and perhaps come up with new ideas or how we can pastorally care for each other. Thank you.
Let us pray our prayer of confession. Merciful God, you made us in your image, with a mind to know you, a heart to love you, and a will to serve you. But our knowledge is imperfect, our love is inconstant, our obedience incomplete. Day by day, we fail to grow into your likeness. You put a new song of praise in our mouths, but we stumble on unfamiliar words. You show us the work to be tackled, but we turn away defiant, insisting we have more important things to do. In your tender love, forgive us, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And the words of assurance: God is faithful and ever-present. The God who knew us before our birth still loves us and strengthens us, that we will one day be blameless. Through the gift of Jesus Christ, God offers forgiveness, grace, and mercy. Amen. And next song is Tis 691, Faith Will Not Grow From Words Alone. Tis 691.
Malcolm has asked Carol and I to talk about the View Club. that we belong to, and quite a few members in this congregation actually belong to View, Tineke, and I'll leave somebody out. The View Club is a women's group which came into existence to give financial support to the Smith family. The acronym means Voice, Interests and Education of Women. Most of you know that the Smith family is a charity. It began life in Sydney 100 years ago and for many years gave financial support to families. Over time, they came to realise that this help was not enough to change lives so that people were able to help themselves. In the late 1980s, it was decided that their focus should change and they should work towards giving educational opportunities to children to help them break out of the poverty cycles. So in 1991, the first student scholarships were offered. Families who could not afford to pay for education were supported on many levels. Many children are able to access university or TAFE courses which would otherwise have been out of reach. Students and parents enter into an agreement with the Smith family. Children must attend school regularly and comply with other rules. In return, they receive not just financial support, but also the help of mentors to help in situations where parents are unable to help. Most of us have no idea how many adults in our country are illiterate. These parents feel so powerless to help their families, and often children are able to help their parents to learn to read later on. View began 60 years ago in the hope that women could be empowered to take leadership roles and grow in confidence. Within the clubs, there are book clubs, discussion groups, walking groups, card and mahjong groups, knitting groups. It is often within these smaller gatherings that these very close friendships are formed. We form wonderful friendships and have great fun while supporting a great cause. We firmly believe that our children are our future, and we have seen the difference the programs have made, not only in the lives of the children, but their entire families. Being sure that they are provided with uniforms, stationery, money for excursions gives children confidence and takes pressures off families who are struggling. My club supports 12 students. This costs about $7,000 each year in a co-sponsorship agreement. We also sent $6,000 last year to a Joy Spreaders program, and this provides for needs over and above the norm. Maybe a computer for a home that doesn't have one, or outings and things for other children. So many opportunities for needing children, and we find this very satisfying. We also support the winter and Christmas appeals. Our wonderful secretary corresponds with the children, and we see great response from some children and nothing from others. But we have over the years received wonderful letters from parents telling us what a difference this has made. So we've been very, very happy to have those supports come through. Carol's going to now talk about how she came into View. And pick up on anything I've forgotten, please.
As many of you know, Ken and I came over to South Australia 3 years ago, leaving all of our wider family. We had two daughters and two granddaughters here, and that was the sum total of people we knew. So friendships became a very important thing, and my first goal was to find a walking group because I'd had a wonderful, supportive walking group in New South Wales, and so that was, as I thought, was an important thing. That was where I found a wonderful group of ladies who supported me through some rather tough times, and it turned out that a lot of these ladies went to this club called View. While I'd heard of View, I hadn't had any real contact. Eventually I was asked to go along, which I did, and there I have found many friends and there have been social opportunities. But one of the things that I've done out of View is a book club, and our current book is called The Happiest Man on Earth. I don't know if many of you have read that. Eddie JQ, who was a Jewish fellow who was imprisoned in Auschwitz his family were all killed, and he was there. He was, because he was Jewish, and but he was too German to be not. The Jews were suspicious of him because he was German. And there was one person in the camp that he had known from his previous life. And this person became very special to him because he was just a connection. And he says, "This is the most important thing I've ever learned. The greatest thing you'll ever do is to be loved by another person. I cannot emphasise this enough, especially to young people. Without friendship, a human is lost. A friend is someone who reminds you to feel alive." And VUE has one of the tenets of VUE is friendship amongst women. And that has been extremely important in my journey over the last 3 years. The bonus is that it does support education for children in disadvantaged places. And so Ken was very supportive of that, obviously, because he'd been involved in helping with reading in the local high school for the last umpteen years. And that, so that was very special to him. And it seems the importance of friendships has kind of come up to me over the last week and even last night. I don't know if many of you are watching Call the Midwife. There was one lady there who was struggling with living in community, and apologies to Vanessa Redgrave, but Jennifer Worth's voice comes over at the end, and it says, "We can be courageous when we stand on solid ground, when we know who our friends are, when we know what we should do, and when we are able to say, this is who I am, this is what I cherish, and this is what I take, and this is what I give back in exchange. Sometimes we choose our paths. Sometimes only our only choice is how we make our journey. Alone and resolute, or I can't read my writing. I wrote it quickly this morning off the voice. Or trusting in those who can uphold us and guide us. Solitude is not armour, and the need for others is not weakness. We're all at our strongest when we find our selfhood and embrace it. Just enough company, just enough space, and always, always the exact amount of friendship and of love." And so this is what, in part, some of the ladies at VUE have given me. Thank you.
Our first reading this morning comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 to 9 from the Message. "I, Paul, have been called and sent by Jesus according to God's plan, along with my friend Sosthenes. I send this letter to you in God's church at Corinth, believers cleaned up by Jesus and set apart for a God-filled life. I include in my greeting all who came out to Jesus wherever they live. He's their master as well as ours. May all the gifts and benefits that come from God our Father and the Master Jesus Christ be yours. Every time I think of you, and I think of you often, I thank God for your lives of free and open access to God given by Jesus. There's no end to what has happened to you. It's beyond speech, beyond knowledge. The evidence of Christ has been clearly verified in your lives. just think, you don't need a thing, you've got it all. All God's gifts are right in front of you as you wait expectantly for our Master Jesus to arrive on the scene for the finale. And not only that, but God himself is right alongside to keep you steady and on track until things are all wrapped up by Jesus. God, who got you started in this spiritual adventure, shares with us the life of his Son and our Master, Jesus. He will never give up on you. Never forget that. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our second reading of Scripture is from John 1, verses 29 to 42, from the New International Version. The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is the one I meant when I said, 'A man who comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was that he might be revealed to Israel." Then John gave this testimony: "I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. And I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, 'The man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain is the one who will baptize with Holy Spirit.' I have seen and I have testified that this is God's chosen one." The next day, John was there again with two of his disciples. When he saw Jesus passing by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." When the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, "What do you want?" They said, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" "Come," he replied, "and you will see." So they went and saw where he was staying, and they spent the day with him. It was about 4 in the afternoon. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what Jesus had said and who had followed Jesus. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, "We have found the Messiah, that is, the Christ." And he brought him to Jesus. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Part of our church management is that we have a leadership team: church councillors and elders, and we've recently elected 2 new church councillors, and this morning an opportunity to acknowledge and to welcome them, although Raj is still in India, so we'll have to do this by proxy, and when he comes back we'll also have a reflection to welcome him into this role, and also to affirm those who have stood again to continue in this ministry and for those who are continuing to serve. So Roy, I know you've just sat down. I'd like to invite you to come again and to come out to the front. Daryl and Sue. Robert and Heather. Aileen. Ken. These are our leadership team. These are the people who prayerfully and often wisely but humbly recognise what God might be saying to us as a community. And they're good listeners too, as they listen to your concerns, as they listen to each other. So there's an opportunity for us to commission and to acknowledge these as part of our leadership group. So in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we are now to receive and welcome these friends whom God has called and whose calling the church has recognised to serve as church councillors and elders in our church. As servants of Christ in this church, they are called to share with the minister in the tasks of pastoral care, leadership and stewardship within the life and mission of this congregation. Trust them, pray for them, and at all times help them in the work of the Lord. So there would be a response for you, I would say, and if you are willing to acknowledge that, your response would be, as disciples of Jesus Christ, we do. And if you can see the screen over there, it's a bold print on the bottom. It's a bit far. So, as disciples of Jesus Christ, we do. So, do you believe that God has called you through his church to this office? And do you promise, in dependence upon his grace, to exercise this ministry faithfully? As disciples of Jesus Christ, we do. Now I look to the congregation. That's all of us. Will you, the members of this congregation, accept these people as leaders among you? Sorry? Good. Will you encourage them in love and support them in their ministry, serving with them the one Lord Jesus Christ? It's good that we can affirm this, and for those who are watching online or later, we would encourage you to continue to support and pray for our leadership team in our congregation here. There's an opportunity for us to pray for these people. You may choose to stand or kneel. Either is okay. And if you would like to offer a hand of support and friendship, I'd invite you, if you are able, to come forward, or you could simply just remain where you are and just raise your hand out as we would pray for our leaders today. So I would invite, if anybody would like to come forward and just rest a hand on a shoulder, or just stand with in solidarity, or simply just raise your hand. There's an opportunity for us to do that now. Let us pray. Loving God, we wonder at the way you call women and men into partnership with you for the sake of your saving purposes for the world. You call us in Christ and empower us by your Spirit so that your church may be built up and your gospel proclaimed and lived. We thank you for these brothers and sisters whom you have called to serve you within this fellowship. We give you thanks for all you give us through them, for their following of Jesus and their willingness by your grace to serve together. So we commission them for ministry. We ask your blessing on them. Guide and equip them by your Spirit, that your church may grow in wisdom, love, and unity, and that your name may be glorified through Jesus Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen. Thank you. Before you go, Aileen? Before you go? So could we just have that screen? Thank you. No? Yes. May God give you the strength to fulfill these vows. And to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus from generation to generation forever. Amen. Amen. Thank you. If we cast our minds back to the Bible reading that Roy read to us, 1 Corinthians 1, there's a real encouragement there as we see the words of Paul talking to the Corinthian church. Now, history tells us that the Corinthian church was far from perfect, that they had their problems and their issues. But what an introduction to this letter. Paul, who's been called by and sent by Jesus the Messiah, I send you this letter to the believers in Corinth, believers cleaned up by Jesus and set apart for a God-filled life. I include my greeting to all who call out to Jesus wherever they live. There's a sense of the beginning of how you made your way into coming into understanding who Jesus was and following the path and the example that Jesus set, of being renewed and refreshed, being saved and reborn, becoming part of this new community of God's children. We find that that beginning is something we're celebrating. And may all the gifts and benefits that come from God our Father and the Master Jesus Christ be yours. It's a real encouraging letter. It's acknowledging their beginnings and it's acknowledging that they continue on in that ministry. They continue to do the best. Yes, they do have issues. But working through the letter, we'll find that the study and the journey that they are on is not about perfection. It's not about getting everything right, but it's about their commitment to following Jesus, to persevering, to being faithful, to being open to the Word of God, and to being vulnerable to the Spirit as the Spirit continues to move in and through their lives. It's a great letter to speak to us about all of our journeys, about how we, each one of us at different stages, but somehow we've all found ourselves together here in this place at this time, and that God is present with us, that God never gives up on us, that God continues on our journey through. And our journey is worth celebrating. It's worth acknowledging that we continue to serve God, that God continues to sustain us and guide us through our journey. We would all like to be better. We would all like to not be as stupid, ignorant, selfish, painful, irritating, angry, all of the things and those words which we find easy to use about ourselves. They have a level of truth in them, but so does also the truth that we are children of God. And that God journeys with us, and that God delights in our efforts and our life and our existence and our ability to commit to continue on this journey. These words are an encouragement to us as we recognize that they make us aware of our insufficiencies, and yet rely more deeply upon the grace of God and the power that is with us. We are God's children, followers of Jesus. The second reading from John speaks to us of the interaction between John the Baptist and Jesus. And last week we reflected on the baptism of Jesus. And here we find a reading that sort of is a couple of days after, where John is recognizing that Jesus is the Lamb of God. And in openness and vulnerability, John is fine to let those who follow him move away and follow someone greater. Jesus is wandering past, and John says, "Look, the Lamb of God." Two of his disciples turn and follow Jesus. And they have an interesting question from the King James Version. It probably says, "Where do you live?" The New International Version says, "Teacher, where are you staying?" And Jesus says, come and see. Come and see where I am. There's something about this spirit life journey, this holiness pursuit. It happens in real life. It doesn't happen in the tabernacle. It doesn't happen in the synagogue alone. It doesn't happen at the lake or by the seashore where there are miracles or healings alone. It happens in the context of where I live. Come and see. Come and stay with me. Come and recognize where I live. I'm a believer in that often if we take the time to sit and listen, we can see God at work in all sorts of places and often in the small things. Tineke is a lovely worship leader and she prepares and she does a great, great task. And this morning when she was giving details about who was participating and what was happening, in her phrase about my role, she said, "Malcolm is the message." A slip of the tongue. I think she meant to say Malcolm will bring the message or Malcolm will deliver the message. But what if we took that phrase in essence of truth and reality, that Malcolm is the message, that Tineke is the message, that Roy is the message, that Graham is the message, that Russell and Ken is the message, that all of us are the message. How we live and who we are, the essence of God incarnate, God present in our lives. The disciples, the followers of John the Baptist, went to see Jesus, and when they saw him in the place where he lived, they believed. It says that Andrew was so convinced that he went to find his brother, and he brought his brother, Simon Peter, to meet Jesus. It's as simple as that. We tend to get a bit nervous about evangelism. We tend to think we have to have all the right Bible verses, or we have to have the right music, or we have to have it all in the right context, and we don't want people to argue with us, and we don't want them to ridicule us or to make fun of us. But the reality is, in life, where we live and who we are is where God speaks most significantly. It's often been quoted that St. Francis of Assisi has a phrase that said, "Preach the gospel, use words when necessary." Your life is the message. Christine and Carol spoke to us of the View Club and the way in which those women gather together to seek to make a difference. Carol spoke to us of those words again on a secular show called The Midwife, a way in which we look back at the life in the 1950s or 60s, I'm not sure when it is, but the way in which those people lived their lives and spoke about words of being friends, that you don't exist alone, that you have to be part of the community. And then from the concentration camp, amongst people belittled and rejected, the words from the gentleman about being a friend, of having connection, and know that you are loved by someone else. This message, this ability to move and share the truth of Jesus is about living where we are, living in our context, recognizing that God is part of our journey, that you and I are the message, the truth of God's love and grace in human life. People need to see that. People need to hear that. They don't need a glossy leaflet. They don't need Bible verses rammed down their throats. They don't need an impressive building or hundreds of people. They need to know the reality of God in the life of you. They need to see God present in your life. You need to be able to say to people, "Come and look at my life. flaws and all. Its existence is given greatness because of God's grace in my life. My life of separateness, my life of holiness, my life of sacredness is because every moment and every day I have a connection with a God who truly and deeply loves me for who I am and who accepts me with all my mistakes. I trust in this God. I believe in this God. Sometimes in this concept of trying to be an evangelist, of trying to share the message of Jesus, of trying to make a difference in people's lives, we've gone and we've persisted with the idea that we have to get all the words right. How many arguments and how many fights over the history of the church has there been when we started talking about I believe and my creed is different to yours and I've got a different word there or I've said a different sentence there. We've got so twisted and so concerned about getting all the words right instead of saying, let us live who God is. Let us trust in this Jesus. Let us allow the Spirit to move and motivate our lives together. Yes, it is important what we say, and there are some differences, and we find that churches and other groups around our world, we find that there's arguments that we have. Okay, we look at that. It's important, but it's not the essence. For Jesus is the message. For Andrew, Simon Peter, as we heard this morning, Malcolm is the message. Tineke is the message. Roy is, and I could go on and on and on. You know your name. Fill in the gap. Live your life in context. It's important for us to have a creed and have a belief. But there's one word that often when people get involved in beliefs, they miss out. Have you heard the word before? Therefore. You can recite your creed, I believe, but if there's no therefore, it's simply an academic exercise. I believe in a loving God. Therefore, my life reveals God's love. I believe in Jesus Christ who died and saved me. Therefore, I live a sacrificial life. I believe in the power of the Holy Spirit. Therefore, my life is impacted by the power of the Spirit. Do you get what I'm saying? Yeah, we know it. Let's remind ourselves and encourage ourselves in community. So as part of our covenanting today, there's a few slides on the screen. We can have that first one that should be says we are called to be a worshiping community. Okay, now you said that really well. But you've got to do a therefore in there. It's not written in the script. If we believe we're called to be a worshiping community, therefore we've got to pray. If we believe we're called to be a missionary community, therefore we've got to let people know about the redeeming love of God. So as we go through these and we respond, it's not just a sentence, it's a therefore, a commitment, a covenant for us to be involved. So, let's move through these slides. We are called to be a worshiping community, offering all to God in prayer. We are called to be a missionary community, making known the redeeming love of God. We are called to be a sacrificial community, generously giving from all that God has given us. That's a big therefore. We are called to be an inclusive community, seeking, sharing the hospitality of God's kingdom with all. That's a big therefore. We are called to be a prophetic community, challenging powers that oppress and corrupt. That's another big therefore. But all of us are the message, and all of us can be engaged in some way in the life that we live. As we continue with the words on the screen. As a gospel people, let us covenant together before God and each other. Creating and redeeming God, we give you thanks and praise. Your covenant of grace was made for our salvation in Jesus Christ our Lord. We come this day to covenant with you and with our companions in discipleship, to watch over each other and to walk together before you in ways known and still to be made known. Pour down your Holy Spirit upon us. Help us so to walk in your ways that the promises we make today and the lives that we live together may become an offering of love, our duty and delight, truly glorifying to you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. This day, next one. This day, we give ourselves again to the Lord and to each other, to be bound together in fellowship and to work together in the unity of the Spirit for the sake of God's mission. In our congregation, in local partnerships, in our presbytery and synod, we commit all that we have and all that we are to fulfill God's purposes of love. Okay, and it's okay if you've forgotten what you said in the beginning, because God journeying with you will enable you to do it day after day after day if you live the message in your context. So now may the God of hope fill us with all joy and peace in believing, that we may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Now unto him who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than we can ask or imagine, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Well, that's a lot of words, but the reality is you are God's people and you live your life where you live. So be faithful and trust that God is covenanting with you as you seek to serve him and us together. So we continue in worship, an opportunity for us to sing together in song 686, Lord Jesus, we belong because we bear your name. I'd invite us to stand and share in this today.
Thank you.
God's work here on earth, let us dedicate the offering. Faithful God, we thank you for calling us to be your holy people in fellowship with your Son. Take our lives and our possessions and use them for your service. Amen. Let us pray for others. Loving God, because the world's problems and miseries are so vast and complex, and because we are neither wise enough nor resourceful and strong enough to put things right, we pray for your divine assistance in every sphere. Please assist those who are dealing with the after effects of the flooding we have seen in so much of our country and elsewhere. Let there be good decision making and wise solutions put in place to reduce further suffering. We think of those who are struggling for justice and peace among nations and communities. Be with them. Please assist those who are trying to govern wisely and those who administer justice. We pray for Europe. Let there be peace, O God, and an end to the conflict. Please assist those who, through research or hands-on care, are fighting disease and suffering. We think especially of COVID and the healthcare workers, even after 3 long years of it. We thank you for the improved treatments and the health care that we receive in this country. We think of those who care for the dignity of the unemployed, the homeless, those struggling to find work. Be there for them, and we pray for good decision making on all levels. Please assist those who give schooling to our children and advance skills to young adults. We pray for the leaders in our community, those who are involved in leading churches, hospitals, industry, and aged care facilities. We think today of our church council and pray that you will guide their decision making for our church. We think of our government, state and federal, and pray for wise counsel. Please assist those that are ill or waiting for surgery. Let them be assured that you are with them always. Please assist those who, despite the help that is offered, are still finding it hard to cope and find themselves at their wits' end. Loving God, friend of all who turn to you, and friend also of those who in anger turn away from you, in your love embrace this world with your almighty tenderness and lead us from all that is hurtful and destructive to grace, mercy and peace. In the name of Christ Jesus, amen. And let us now say the word that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours now and forever. Amen. Our concluding song this morning is from Tis 675, Shine Jesus Shine, Tis 675.
Thank you.
full of activity, full of brightness and shining and doing stuff. So where you live, you do stuff. You live and you eat and you breathe. Just be God's person and know that God is with you and in you, and share that grace. We've said a lot of words today to covenant and commission. Now let's live it where we live. So go out in God's name. Know that you are God's message. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.